Ideas, imagination, inspiration, macro world. Here's your host, Ray Scott.
Hi, and great to have you aboard for another installment of Macro World. Well, those of you who followed me on my other channel, Visual Art Photography, you know how I feel about camera gear. Essential, yes, but is it the most important element in your photography? For me, the answer is no. To me, the most important piece of equipment is between your two ears. Having said that, if you don't have some kind of camera equipment, you can't get out all of that creativity that is between your ears. So today on Macro World, we're going to take a look at some equipment that you can use to take some great macro photography. Now, I'm not showing you every example of equipment that you can use for macro photography. I'm going to show you what I use. It doesn't mean it's the best way to do things. It's just the way I do it. It's one way. There are many ways. Now, for me, I like using a macro lens. Now, for some, perhaps for budgetary reasons or just for preference, they prefer to use something like a reversal ring and then use a regular lens and put it on the camera backwards and get in close that way. Or others may want to use some kind of a close-up filter on their lens. All these things are fine. It's totally up to you. This is what I use. So the first thing is I use a 100 millimeter macro lens, f2.8 from Canon. I say Canon because this is the equipment that I use. Is it better than something else? No, it's just my preference. It's the system that I bought in 2 years ago, and I continue to use all of the elements in the Canon system. But you can be using Nikon or Sony or Panasonic or any number of other manufacturers and independent lens manufacturers, all kinds of different things. So that's neither here nor there. But this gets me in close. This gets me to life size. And I love that fact that I can use this and get in life size. But to show you the trip I took to get to this lens, because I haven't had this lens for that long, just for a couple of years, what I was using was this lens, which is a macro compact lens, which got me to half life size. Great lens, fabulous lens, very clear, no problems. But I wanted to get a bit closer than just life size. So what I did was, and this was many, many years ago, before you bought stuff online, I went to the local camera store and I bought this, which is an adapter specifically designed to go with this half life-size macro lens, and this combined brought me to life size. So it was a good solution for me, and it fit my budget at the time as well. Now, the thing is, you have to get very, very close to the subject to get the life size. And what that was doing was, if I was shooting something like insects or things like that, I had to get really, really close, and they just always moved away. But for anything else that was static or anything, it was very good. It sometimes compromised my lighting just a little bit, but it wasn't really a major hassle, and I was pretty comfortable with it. But like I said, a few years ago, I decided, you know something? Go the whole piece with this. And there was a reason why I did that too. And that's because life-size macro lens and this adapter works with this lens too. And this brings this lens up to 2 times life size. So now I'm getting really close to my subject. And of course, things are very clear. Now, another piece of equipment that I use for my macro photography, you may want to use it too, very economical, extension tubes. These ones are from Kenko. And the thing with this is that you have contact elements and so on and so forth, which is great, so that you can get your readings, all of the readings that you need for your, you know, shutter speed and things like that. But they come apart. They come apart. There's 3 different pieces here. So I can use these at different settings and come up with all kinds of different things. Meaning that I can use this and get my photography to 3 times and sometimes even 3.5 times life size. Fabulous stuff. So I go from life size to around 3.5 times. That is macro photography. Lots of fun. But lighting can be an issue. Now, to be honest with you, a lot of my macro photography over the years has been with natural light just coming in from a window. More recently, I use a lot of studio lighting, but it's not essential. But sometimes you want to stop some action, you're doing some insects, or you just want lighting flexibility, and so you can use flash. Now, for years when I did use flash, I just used a regular flash, often with a wire so that it was off-camera flash. But now, I use a macro ring light. And this is fantastic because you know something is really, really flexible. Now this one, particular one, is from Yongnuo. You know, obviously Canon has one too, but this was a lot less expensive than the one from Canon. So I got this and it works great. So that's an option. Very, very solid too, you know. Made very well, actually. Surprisingly well for the price. So if you like flash for your photography or you want to do some stop action water things, you know, and drops and stuff like that, it's a way to go. By the way, before we go any further, I'm just going to go a few other things. I was mentioning visual art photography off the top, my other channel. If you're interested in going to that for all kinds of different photography other than macro, although there are some macro tutorials on there, the link is down below. Okay, so what's in here? This looks promising, doesn't it? Well, it is, because it is a tabletop tripod. That can come in really, really handy when you're doing tabletop work, or even sometimes outside. But I use that from time to time. Well, this one's from Manfrotto, and nice and solid, you know, metal and heavy and everything else. And there's an extension on here so that you can have it stand higher and all kinds of different things. So tabletop tripod can be very, very good and very useful depending on what kind of macro photography you're doing. And by the way, I use a tripod for my macro photography almost exclusively, a regular tripod. Unless I'm doing something outside and it does have to do with insects and they're moving, I may, you know, try to jostle back and forth for focus and things like that and keep up with them, just handheld. But generally with my macro photography, I use a tripod. So a lot of people over the years have asked me, Ray, do you use a focusing rail? Well, here's the answer. I have a focusing rail, and I end up using it about 20 or 25% of the time. The rest of the time, I take my tripod and my camera and I kind of jockey back and forth and things like that. But these can be really great if you need some precise work done. Now, the thing with this one is it's by Manfrotto. It's solid metal. There's no plastic on it at all. And it's fabulous. But the thing is, it only moves your camera front to back. Now, that's good. It even has a very fine feature on here where you can finely focus. You can move your camera to basically where you want it, then you can turn it and just get like really, really precise focusing. It's great, back and forth. But all the latest focusing rails that I've seen not only have the front to back, but they have the side to side, and that's got to be great. And I honestly, I've been thinking about getting one that goes from side to side as well. But like I said, I only really use this as about 20, 25% of the time. So probably not. Do without. It's not a big deal. Now, with the advent of the digital camera and the screen on the back of the camera, what I'm going to show you now is not necessary anymore. But back in the days of film, I used to use this right angle finder. And this is a beautiful piece of equipment. It really, really is. Because what it does is it goes onto your viewfinder, and if you're doing something down low, you just peer down into it and it shows you the image at a right angle, and it just makes photography wonderful. But now, of course, like I said, with the screen on the back and sometimes flip screens and everything like that, it kind of is not necessary anymore. But there it is. Now, lots of other ways you can do macro photography. Never forget that obviously in macro photography, focusing is super, super critical. But if you can focus right, and with all the megapixels that, you know, your camera sensor has, if you can only get to say half life size, all right, as an example, but you really want it to be life size, take your picture, make sure it's super well focused, and then crop it in and get in closer. And trust me, no one will know the difference, all right? So that's a trick that you can use for your macro photography, but focus is critical. Okay, so that's my setup. That's the macro photography equipment that I use. Yours is probably very different. If you're just new to photography and you're just getting into macro photography, maybe this will give you a little bit of an idea of where to start. And as I mentioned, close focusing filters, reversal rings to put your lens on your camera backwards to get you in close, and there's other techniques too. All right, so all's not lost if you don't have a large budget or if you're just starting out and you're not quite sure if you want to make the full commitment into macro photography. There are ways to do it. This is one way to do it. You can build up over the years and so on and so forth. Try different things. Hope you enjoyed the presentation. And until next time, I'm Ray Scott reminding you to shoot small and think big.